For the last weeks since January, we've been going through the Gospel of Mark, trying to find really important stories about Jesus, because we want to understand the story of Jesus. We want to understand the life of Jesus, because we understand that the stories we tell, the stories we listen to, the stories we share, shape our lives and shape who we are. And we as a community of faith, we as people wrestling with real life, we want our life to be shaped by the story of Jesus. And so this week, we're looking at a story of Jesus walking on water, like you all do, I'm sure. I love it that there's so many of these stories in the Bible, Jesus walking on the water. And this particular story is one of my favorite moments, where the disciples are struggling, and Jesus is like, yeah, I'm just going to keep walking by. I love that moment. That's awesome. But to be really shaped by today's story, we should perhaps begin with a premise. We all have a past that haunts us. And to prove to you that I have a past that haunts me, I thought I would show you this picture. That is me, senior year, going to prom. I don't know if you can fully tell, but I allowed my mom to convince me that with my long hair, she should blow dry it so that I could go to my senior year prom looking like Fabio. We all have a past, and some of it haunts us. I am haunted. Why did I allow my mom to convince me that this was a good idea? We all have a past. We all have a past filled with things that, if we're honest, haunt us like bad senior pictures. But some things in our past haunt us at like a deeper level. We all have a past. We all have shadows in our lives. We all have things that we've kept hidden in the closet. We all have like old wounds. We all maybe have some fresh grief. We all have a past. Some things in that past can deeply, deeply haunt us. In the ancient Near East, people were aware of the shadows in the world, the things that haunt us. And for many in the ancient Near East, the ancient Middle East, they saw the entire sea as being filled with nothing but the things that haunt us in life. The Sea of Galilee, any ocean, any body of water, was described as the force of chaos. It was the very thing that haunted people. Everything that could possibly haunt you in ancient Near Eastern culture was there present in the sea. All the shadows, all the ghosts, there in the seas. The seas were even said to be somehow like alive with the force of chaos. Some cultures even believe that the sea had a goddess, and they called her Tiamat. And there's a really bad anti-feminist joke there about the seas being chaos and goddess being a woman. I'm not going to go there because I'm progressive. But the idea was that the things that haunt us in life were there present in the seas. There were things that haunt us, and they were there. Dark matter, dark energy, scary things. It's interesting too. Modern physics tells us that we know about 3 to 4% of what makes up the entire universe. We know 3 to 4% of matter, which means 96 to 97% of the universe is made up of stuff that we're not quite sure about, and so we call it dark matter. We call it dark energy. We don't quite know what it all is or how it all works. The universe is comprised of 97% of like darkness, which could be a little scary. And yet physicists and cosmologists and scientists would tell us that this dark matter, this dark energy, is necessary and vital for the ongoing life of the universe. This stuff that we don't know about, this scary stuff, is somehow 97% of the universe is necessary and vital for the existence of the universe. The ancient Near Eastern people were also very much aware that even though the seas were terrifying, somehow that dark and shadowy, scary stuff was necessary and vital for the life of creation. And if we're honest with ourselves, our pasts, our haunts, the things that make us uneasy, they're kind of necessary and vital for our own life. The things that haunt us are the things that allow us to keep going. How do we confront the storms in life? How do we move forward? I'm reminded of another story of a woman who was dealing with great grief and great sorrow and a great storm. Because in a village in which everyone had kids that needed to have kids, that wanted to have kids, she finally had a kid after years and years and years. And yet soon after her baby was born, her baby died. So in this village full of babies and full of life, she lost her baby. And it completely devastated her. And she began hearing rumors that up on the village mountain, there was a healer. There was an old man who could do all kinds of healing and bring new life. So she decided that she was going to seek out this healer, this old wise man. So she went up the mountaintop to seek this wise man, to seek divine intervention. Because she felt the only way to move forward was to seek divine intervention. The disciples, after Jesus sent them onto the boat, into the middle of the sea, into the storm, the thing that terrifies them the most, when the storm rages, they too seek divine intervention. Jesus walks through the storm, the chaos, the unknown, and the frightful, after he spends some time up on a mountain meditating and praying. And then he notices that the disciples are in the midst of the sea, the thing that terrifies them the most, and there's a storm going on, so he decides he's going to head into the storm too. Now, presumably, Jesus could meander around. He could walk for longer to get to the other side, but Jesus knows that the only way to really get to the other side when you're faced with a storm is not to go around it. Not to avoid it, it's to go through it. And so after praying and meditating, Jesus, with an inner calm, moves deep into the heart of the storm. Jesus walks into this storm and walks with an inner calm through all the waves and the raging tide and the scary and the chaos and the things that frighten us. Jesus walks through it. And he sees that the disciples are struggling with their oars to move through the storm, to move through the chaos, to move through the things that terrify, that are frightening. Jesus sees them. But again, in one of my favorite moments, Jesus kind of just like, I don't know, Charlie Brown style, whistles past them. Like, they're good. I can just keep moving. But they seek divine intervention. Because moving through storms is tough. Jesus sees them struggling, but believes that he doesn't actually need to stop for them, because Jesus knows a profound truth. It is necessary and vital for the ongoing nature of our life to struggle. Jesus knows it's necessary and vital for our lives to go through the storms and struggle. We are hardwired neurologically, biologically, and spiritually for struggle. When there's a storm in our life, when there's a wound in our life, when there's a grief in our life, when there's something that causes us to feel like, no way, that's all kinds of dark matter, dark energy, I don't want to deal with that. We are called to go through it and to struggle. No one in their right mind would ever wake up and say, I want to go through the struggle today. Whenever we're faced with something that just sucks, no one ever says, yes, I'm going to grow. But that's what the story is calling us to do. To quote Brené Brown, the story is calling us to embrace the suck. To embrace the storm. And to move through it, to struggle. Because it's in the struggling that we develop new muscles. The struggle is how we learn. It's how we grow. It's how we develop new ways of seeing and living and thinking and being. We have to struggle. We have to work it out. Struggling is necessary and vital for the ongoing nature of our life and our story. And Jesus, when he sees the disciples struggling, doesn't need to stop because he believes that together they can figure it out, that they'll figure the struggle out. And Jesus believes in every single one of us. Whatever you're going through, whatever future storm you're going to face, you're going to make it through. Jesus believes you can make it through. How we move through complexities, conflicts, stress, anxiety, and despair, challenges, we struggle to get through them. But we do get through them. We journey into the dark matter, into the storm, into the chaos, and we struggle. And we go to the places where there is pain and suffering in our own lives. And we embrace the struggle. We embrace the suck. But we do come out the other side a new person. A little more complex. A little more caring. A little more compassionate. A little more healed. We can't avoid the storm. Anytime something happens to us, all the dark matter in our lives, we can avoid. But dark matter is necessary for the ongoing nature of the universe. The nature of the universe is that it's constantly expanding and moving forward. And if we don't embrace the dark matter, we don't get to move forward. And we stay stuck and bitter and resentful. It is necessary for the ongoing nature of the universe. It's necessary and vital for us to embrace the storms, to move through the storms, to keep growing, and to keep going. The disciples at first mistake Jesus as unknown and frightful. They mistake him to be a ghost. Because sometimes the things that we're most terrified of, sometimes the dark matter in our lives we're most afraid of facing, is the very thing that's necessary and vital for our ongoing health and growth. And so the woman who is seeking divine intervention gets up to the top of the mountain, and the old man says, I can do something for your baby. I can bring new life. What I need you to do is to bring me a strand of hair from the one household in your village that has not been struck by grief or some kind of storm. And so she descends down the mountain, and she goes from house to house, and she shares her story of great grief and anguish. And at every single house, they share with her stories of storms and dark matter and grief. House to house to house. She spends 6 months learning stories of grief and sharing storms. Like the disciples, struggling together. And after 6 months, she takes her baby and she buries him and finds new life. none of us would wish this story upon our worst enemy. None of us would ever wish any of the dark matter in our lives on our worst enemy. And yet, over and over and over again, when we talk to people about the moments that most transformed them in their lives, they never mention, well, one time I aced the spelling bee. One time I was awesome, and then that changed everything for me. When people talk about the moments in their lives that most transformed them, when we talk to the most interesting people in the world who are the most compassionate and gracious and loving and amazing, the most awesome people, they will all talk about the time in which things sucked and how they moved through it. So may you, my brothers and sisters, siblings, may you in times of great storms, may you in times in which you're aware that your world is full of all kind of dark matter, may you embrace it. May you move through it. And may you know that you can walk through any storm. You can walk on water. Amen?
Amen.